An impossible frontier. The Discovery Channel presents The Space Shuttle. This two-hour Discovery special video presentation takes you behind the scenes for the first time as you witness the drama and majesty of the Space Shuttle firsthand from the people who've made it possible. To order The Space Shuttle for only $24.95, call 1-800-417-1616. The Space Shuttle. Man's grasp has now equaled his reach. Chrysler Cirrus has an advanced 24-valve.
If anything, I think NASA has failed to communicate how really complicated it is to do spaceflight. It's certainly not American Airlines running on some timetable to New York. And as a matter of fact, it's an enormous challenge to get one of these things off the ground. I'm always amazed that it works at all. You know, and that's from being inside of it.
So we're gonna have to pull the line back out. Alignment didn't make it, so
yeah.
Pull the line back out.
Dash 1-1.
The shuttle main engines are high performance engines operated at 104% of their design capabilities, and so we're having to look at the turbo pumps and pieces of the engine after each mission and often replace them.
Right there. That's what I'm thinking of what we're seeing.
The aft compartment of the shuttle is kind of like a maze. I refer to it as a space-rated Swiss Family Robinson's treehouse. The paradoxes there are unbelievable. You have a titanium thrust structure that holds thousands and thousands and thousands of pounds of thrust. Right next to it, you have a phenomenal amount of plumbing and wiring, and it's all very sensitive and very delicate. Imagine being back here during an orbital liftoff. You've got gallons and thousands of gallons of liquid oxygen flowing through this feed line, and it's coming from the external tank disconnect located down there. Everything that we do down here has to be perfect, because when you go into orbit, there is no way of getting back there and working on anything.
I thought, well, the shuttle will just be another easy system. You know, within a matter of weeks, a couple weeks after getting the books on, I'll study it up and I'll be ready to go fly it. And it turned out to be not the case.
Aircraft is a highly modified Gulfstream II, flies almost exactly like the space shuttle. The performance has been modified so it descends like the space shuttle. The same descent rate, the same type of drag. It's very, very important training for shuttle pilots, because the shuttle is a very difficult aircraft to fly, and it's very different from any other airplane that I've flown in my life.
We have an instructor pilot in the right seat who gets the airplane up to about 35,000 feet. And at that point, we put the engines into reverse, and you're rapidly on your way down to Earth at the rate of 22,000 feet a minute.
Airlines, you come in at about a 2% glide angle coming down. Shuttle comes in 22%. That's going downhill real fast.
Before your fly as a commander, you typically have about 1,000 approaches, and you get about 10 a flight, so about 100 flights in the shuttle training aircraft.
It's a real nice process coming back. When you hit the Earth's atmosphere, you're doing Mach 25 or about 18,000 miles an hour. And the way you slow down is by pancaking or sort of speed breaking the orbiter into the Earth's atmosphere. And that's why the tile are so critical on the bottom, is that they absorb that heat.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11.
Okay, that's it.
Lower surface tiles can protect up to 2,500 degrees. It is sometimes hard to believe that it protects it like it does. It's strictly real thin aluminum underneath. That's all it is.
Good in there. 113, 115, 7, 106.
It's a giant jigsaw puzzle that has 35,000 different shapes and sizes of tiles.
Next row, 12, 23.
The tiles were masterpieces of thermodynamic engineering, but they were also a nightmare for developing and building a new vehicle. There were 31,000 tiles on the first shuttle on the Columbia. They all had to be put on by hand.
And it did seem like an endless job, like something we would never perfect. They were so fragile. It seemed like every time you were working on them, something went wrong.
It took a total of 670,000 hours to put them on, 335 man years. A worker could install about two in a week. It was a nightmare.
If one sees an infrared image of the shuttle, you see that there are extremely hot places on the forward edges of the wings and the tails and other places on the fuselage.
We got quite a light show out here right now.
It was really like flying inside of a neon tube. We were looking out through there, and all of a sudden this glow started at about 300,000 feet.
There's this nice, soft orange light that surrounds the vehicle. It doesn't look all that hot, but it's there because it is hot.
We're sure looking at 2,000 to 3,000 degrees right outside the window. It was awesome and very impressive, and it worked.
In the Apollo days, when the capsules came in, all the heat protection burned off. But what we do now keeps the astronauts safe. Without us, it doesn't come back.
She rolls out of the orbiter processing facility. We take it to the VAB, which is the vehicle assembly building, the big building.
And then it's brought to this 48-story immense modern cathedral that was designed for the Saturn V rocket, which was much bigger than the shuttle stack. and then it's taken with a crane and grabbed by the nose and hauled vertical and then moved over and mated with its external tank, its expendable fuel tank, and the solid rockets, which themselves have been prepared for several months for this mating.
Although it appears we go overboard in some cases and things do seem to be laborious, there's a lot of thought process put into that. You know, the old carpenter saw, you know, you measure twice and cut once.
Clearly, the shuttle was sold on some false promises, and the most important of those false promises is that it would be routine and inexpensive.
Not only were there no savings, but the space shuttle has been fabulously more expensive than the expendable launch vehicles it replaced.
And it was very clear to many people from the very beginning that this was going to be a cost-ineffective white elephant. And in fact, it has been.
History, science, and technology. And the spectacular photography in Destination Discovery takes you as close as you can get. Now you can get 12 issues, a full year's subscription to Destination Discovery for only $11.97.
I wish there was an easy answer to how you ignite people's free interest in the exciting and tremendous idea of man going into space. When you think back on the old days, and one of the things that JFK was famous for having said, and that is, you take your very best hat and you wear it down the street, and when you come to a wall you know you can't scale, you throw it over. And then you just try to go get it, try to get it back, because you know you can if it means enough to you, and it's the way you find out how much you really can do.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
Well, I guess what you could say about this room, and as you look in here down to where they met up with the Apollo spacecraft, was the final step off to the moon. This is a pretty historic piece of hardware to be laying out here in the sand, but brings back a lot of memories that are looking there. And to see all these arms service the big Saturn. And what you see when you look at all of this is you start to see, and I haven't been near this hardware in years, but you start to see the faces of the people and the way it was back then.
20 seconds and counting. T-minus 15 seconds, guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9, ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
And I guess the 25th anniversary of Apollo kind of puts it all in real perspective, you know, with the how many years it's been and how far we've come, and this is what's left of that big program. It used to be so alive, and now it's near like the bones in a graveyard. It was a massive undertaking, and it took massive hardware, and it took massive people to do it. And they did a hell of a job, as history shows. Exciting show to see the arms coming back and then the arms coming back and then the pull down post release, and it would start to climb out much, much slower than the shuttle today, and it just sort of held on to you for quite a while going up to, as it tried to clear the tower. It was gorgeous.
And Roger
Roger and Ed got killed in the fire? I guess I wasn't too surprised when that happened. I'm sure sorry to miss Gus, because he was a great fellow. And so were Roger and Ed. I think if Gus hadn't gotten killed, he might have been the first person to go to the moon, which had been good.
A friend of mine was showing me a computer game the other day called Civilization. And in that computer game, you get to build the wonders of the world. And one of the wonders of the world was the lunar program. And I thought, gee, that's rather odd that it's in the same category as pyramids and the Great Library of Alexandria and things like that. What an odd thing that this very high-tech thing is a wonder of the world. But in fact, you know, that is kind of how it's looked at, isn't it? That it was a one-time event, it was sustained for a while, and then it was no longer a continuing part of the human experience.
Am I in contact with anyone?
When I look back at Apollo and I look at those films and watch those, look at those pictures, and I think, was I really there? It's almost as if it was a dream. It's hard to place yourself in that scene. It really is. And I look at it and I think, you know, that was absolutely the most wonderful thing that I've ever done in my life. And as young as I was, and here I am in another terrific adventure, and I'm the luckiest person in the world, without a question.
About $3 billion worth of national assets, you know, here on our shoulders, you know, while we're going to the pad, it's pretty mind-boggling. But to me, the more incredible part about the crawler is when you do dock it up at the pad, the accuracy is down to a 1/16 of an inch that we can stop the crawler at, north, south, east, and west. So even though she may be a clumsy beast, she can really put it on a dime. Rolling about a mile an hour at this time. We have about an hour and a half left to go to get to the top of the pad. And Hans is running pretty good. I started calling him Hans and Franz after Beastie Boys, and that's where we got it from, was from a Saturday Night Live clip. They used to have characters on it called Hans and Franz, and they were here to pump you up, and that's what we do.
Developed the shuttle, we used the old facilities that had been created for Apollo and adapted them for shuttle. It's very much a cobbling together of budget-driven design compromises that we see.
It was a learning process of old technology and new technology put together to try to define and place how we can go on from here to do it more efficiently.
There are something like 30,000 people involved in getting a shuttle ready for launch and launching it. That's no way to make it cheap. The idea that we could have done that somehow for $10 million a throw just boggles the mind when you see what actually happens.
NASA was given a very difficult job. And technically, NASA performed. The shuttle is too expensive to operate. We've got to find much faster, cheaper ways of doing it.
time for launch approaches, things get more critical. My mind is reviewing all the things that could be trouble spots. Did we cover everything adequately? Did we check everything? Did we watch everything? Are we really ready? The bottom line is we cannot afford another Challenger accident.
Okay, we've got a main engine flash in the plume of main engine number one. Do you notice any kind of contaminant in the exhaust plume that would cause that?
I didn't see anything obvious. However, I wonder if it's related to that event we saw just prior to this.
And so if it means checking something another time, another 10 times, another 100 times to make sure it's going to operate properly and not jeopardize the crew or the vehicle, we will do that.
The film analysis is like a detective story. We use different formats to piece together the event. For example, a small leak should it occur, or a piece of hardware falling off the shuttle. A wide angle view gives us more time to plot a trajectory, to watch the rotation and characteristics of that piece falling away from the vehicle. We have approximately 80 of these type cameras positioned around the launch pad. They are designed to look at the vehicle from every possible angle so that we can ascertain the condition of the vehicle during the hazardous fueling operation. After the fueling is complete, we come out here with a team called the ICE team.
Got 2 hours to look at every square inch on this vehicle and pronounce it ready for launch. We are well aware that there's over 2 million pounds of solid rocket fuel in the boosters and over 500,000 gallons of cryogenic fuel in the external tank. So it is a hazardous operation. There is potential for major problems there should anything ever occur. So all the team members are volunteers. Actually strikes me as a living, breathing entity. It makes sound. There is the hissing of purge gases escaping, the popping of valves opening and closing, the rumble of the burn stack as we burn off the excess hydrogen. And so you get this impression that it is ready to go and it's catching its breath, waiting to jump off the pad.
My name is Al Sofchi. I'm the shuttle test director at Kennedy Space Center, and my prime function is to lead the launch team on during the launch countdown process, which starts 3.5 days before the actual liftoff. The final hours of launch start approximately 8 to 10 hours before launch, and we come in, we check the weather, make sure we have good weather. We check with all of our systems and all of our support areas around the world and make sure that no one has a problem that would prevent us from tanking or launching.
When you get ready to launch the shuttle from the Kennedy Space Center, you have several emergency landing fields on the other side of the Atlantic Ocean, 6 time zones away. And so if it gets too late in Florida, that means it's already, particularly in the winter, dark in Spain or on the coast of Africa. And so you can cancel a launch because your emergency landing sites are in darkness.
There is no actual button that someone pushes. We have what we call a ground launch sequencer, which is effectively a computer program that takes us down through the last minutes of launch. It can stop itself if it detects a problem, or anyone in the firing room can request a hold if they see a problem.
Well, I'm Bob Seek. I'm the launch director for the space shuttle. My responsibility is to make sure that we don't get launch fever, we don't get carried away in this pyramid of reaching the final go for launch. Everyone is polled where they have to indicate that they are really go to proceed.
NASA test director, this is ICE team.
channel 232. We're complete on the FSS 215-foot level. Everything looks fine.
If I'm comfortable that there's nothing out there that's bugging anybody, then it's fairly easy to give the go-ahead to launch.
Believe it or not, I'm not a risk taker, and so I try to minimize risk, and I look upon launch as one of the riskier parts of space flight. Maybe in the future you'll be able to beam me up there, you know, beam me up there, Scotty, and I would accept that.
The count goes down. You hear T-minus 31 seconds. The onboard computers kick on. You start to get a rush.
The last few seconds, the launch count, there's a lot of dynamic things occurring on the shuttle. Things are powering up, pumps, engines.
You hear the engines kick on. You can see the large steam cloud rise. And then you hold your breath for a few seconds, praying that those solid rocket motors were going to go.
And that 6 seconds seemed to last for an eternity because the vibration was so high, you could feel the shuttle just straining against the launch pad. You think it's going to shake itself apart, and let's hurry up and light, solid rocket motors. Come on, let's go. And then bang, at zero when the solids light.
When those kick on, you're going to go somewhere. The shuttle will not stay at the pad.
The thing is the absolute feeling and the love that the people have here at the center, from the people that work with a wrench to the people that work with the paper, the people that really feel like they're almost physically pushing it off the pad, and their hearts go with it every time, and it's as if it's an absolute member of their family, if not a part of their being.
Big-sized fries and drink from some value menus, and you'll also get a surprise. Not at Wendy's. Our Biggie fries are big. You can't get bigger for 99 cents. And to finish a Biggie drink, you'll probably have to take it with you.
Our Super Value menu, it's everything you expect from Wendy's.
Hello, tech support, Brian.
Yes, I'm having a problem.
What's happening?
Well, my CD-ROM won't play.
Okay, format the boot disk from your A drive. Type device equals C:\DOS. Your computer isn't recognizing the format of the CD. Read the screen to me.
Test driver error.
If you're looking for a multimedia computer that actually works, there's really only one way to go.
Hello?
Brad. Hey, it's George. Yeah, I was wondering if I could come over and use your Mac for a couple hours.
I'm here with a few friends speaking to you on a Motorola cellular phone. You guys ready?
Sure.
We're here to show you that these Motorola phones are built to take a lot of punishment. Everyone okay?
Check. Oh, yeah. Roger.
Is there a tougher cellular phone out there?
Spare me.
Motorola, the best-selling, most preferred cellular phones in the world.
So, Barb, what kind of car are you driving now?
I just leased an Acura Legend.
Ouch.
You don't want to test drive the Eagle Vision, then.
Why not? Come on.
No.
Come on, just want to test drive. Give it a go.
Okay. Don't say I didn't warn you now.
Okay, we'll be back.
Barbara's back in the Eagle Vision. How was it?
Oh, it reminds me of my Acura. It's great. Why didn't you want me to test drive it?
Probably the least price for that kind of mission.
I would guess she paid more.
The Discovery Channel. Explore your world on weekday wings. Find yourself in the cockpits of powerful fighting machines. Patrol the sky in Phantoms, Tomcats, and Thunderjets. Map out strategies, deploy your troops, and engage in combat as you fly fighters. On weekday wings, 7 Mountain, 6 Pacific. Continues all week, beginning Monday on the Discovery Channel.
Reggie nominated Hightower for 3 Cable Neil Ace Yeager, Awards.
Gary Barnhill.
Hear the real story behind the film and the band played on.
They told us as physicians it was safe.
This is Alec Baldwin. In 4 hours, over 2 nights, the Discovery Channel brings you the whole story.
This wasn't fear, this was hatred.
A time of AIDS.
John Buchanan,
beginning
Don
next
C.
Sunday
Batari,
at 10 Mountain,
David
9
Greer,
Pacific.
Jack Caster, John P. Sharp.
My world came apart.
Launch is very fast, it is very violent, it is very noisy. It's basically vibrations and noise. I'm scared of launches, I'm scared to death of launches. I really don't like doing them, but I accept them and I accept that risk. Space is my calling.
The vibration was so tremendous inside the cockpit that those gauges kind of blurred. It was like, well, it's a good thing I've trained so long to study these gauges, I can't read them now.
In the space of about a minute and 45 seconds, we're traveling faster than the fastest rifle bullet. We're above Mach 3.
What will we do if we lose an engine at this point? Will we return to Kennedy, or will we continue to Africa? Will we go to Spain? Or, you know, will we have to dump fuel from our orbital maneuvering engines if we lose an engine at this point, or not dump fuel? And what orbit will we go to? And, you know, so there's all these things that you have to be staying ahead of the vehicle on, thinking if the next malfunction occurs, what do I do?
After 2 minutes and 12 seconds, you're off the solids and you're onto the main engines. That's a smooth ride.
It is a bit of a relief to know that they're gone. And you figure that the main engines have been working just fine for 2 minutes, no reason they shouldn't for another 6. So you're feeling pretty good at that point.
It takes approximately 8.5 minutes of powered flight from a liftoff at the pad until you're going 17,500 miles an hour. When you're on board, that's a very exciting ride, goes by very quickly. When you're sitting in a management position, that is the longest 8.5 minutes in the world.
I said, Ellen, I can actually see the sky turning black. Ellen said, great, and Don said, what are the engines doing? And I came back in and I looked and I said, Don, the engines are great. Ellen, it's really black now, because I was so excited.
You know, MECO is a NASA acronym for Main Engine Cutoff, MECO, Main Engine Cutoff. So you always hear MECO, and there's great smiles that go up in MECO, particularly if it's a safe MECO.
Closing my eyes just as the engine shut down, I was, of course, in free fall. It's rather abrupt from having a 3G push in which you weigh 3 times. I weigh roughly 460 pounds or so, to 0G into free fall. Just a magical experience.
It's euphoria on board. It's euphoric. There's just the whole crew who lets up a cheer. I'm not sure if it's an unspoken thought in everybody's mind or just sheer joy of being there, but it's certainly a little bit of both, you know? We're alive and we're in orbit. You know, I mean, what could be better?
It's an archetypal dream of human flight. You know, we as humans, for as long as we've been humans, have thought about doing that.
insurance salesman called me up. I surprised him. I said, yes, I am interested in life insurance, what he called. And he said, oh, great. You know, I could tell he was, it's probably the one in 100 that he'd got that day. And I said, how old are you? You know, and do you smoke? No, no, good physical condition. Yes, yes, yes. You know, and great, great. And what's your occupation? And I said, well, I'm an astronaut. Dead silence on the phone. Without a doubt, the hardest part is what I do and what I enjoy doing. Is it worth the risk to my family? Because I love my family dearly, and I have three small daughters, you know, a four-year-old, a two-year-old, and a six-month-old now. And when you kiss them goodbye 7 days prior to your scheduled launch as you go into quarantine, because you're not allowed to see your children in quarantine, that's a difficult night.
Danny, a couple of weeks before flight, are you excited about your daddy going up in space? And she said, no. And I said, well, why not? She says, it might blow up. Yeah. So Challenger is still there in the forefront, I think.
That's what I think of every time it goes up. And the boost of separation really bothers me. And my children, you know, laugh at me when we have a joke afterwards, but I jump every time.
Seeing that shuttle going up is like amazing too, because you're watching all this power just push this tremendous shuttle into the air, and it starts to hover at first, and it seems like that's the only thing you care about in the world right now. So.
It's an incredibly dangerous business. You're turning loose so much energy in such a short period of time. You're using such sophisticated techniques and procedures and equipment. We're going to lose people. We're going to lose more people. I think it's only through the dedication of all the fine folks who work in this business we haven't lost more already.
Personally, on that day, I was sitting next to the person who had the responsibility for launch director, and we saw the Challenger destruct in front of us, and it's a moment that those on the team and those that saw it, of course, will never forget.
I was the flow director for Columbia at that period, and we had just landed out in California, and on the way back, I had stopped off in Denver to see my brother. So I was flying back that morning, and I hung around my brother's apartment watching the count, and they had a problem with a hatch, and they were talking about the problems with ice, and time was running. I finally jumped in a cab and had to get to the airport. And I get to the airport, and of course, in an airport, everything's in. So I called my brother real quick, and I said, how's it going? And he said, you have a problem. And I said, what do you mean? He said, a big problem.
The last time I saw Krista McAuliffe, she was very nervous about teaching the lesson from space. I mean, she was going to be live with hundreds of schools. And she turned to me and said, I'm really nervous about all this video stuff. And I was young and feeling very cocky that day. And I said, don't worry. We're going to take real good care of you. You don't have to worry about a thing. And I thought about that an awful lot.
I was at my boss's office. We gravitate to some place where there's a television when it finally comes down to the last few minutes of the count. And we were sitting there watching many secretaries and other people in the room at the same time, and when the spacecraft disappeared in the explosion, of course, no one knew for sure what happened, but they were saying, the SRBs have separated, you know, and at that moment, you could see a couple of SRBs wandering off on their own, and my boss and I looked at each other, you know, and there was no word spoken. I mean, we just knew that we were in deep trouble, that crew was gone.
We don't normally keep the video on in the control room when we're flying, because the video can deceive you. The truth is in the telemetry. But when all the data went away and we heard the reports from the site of an explosion, everybody turned the cameras on and almost turned on the video. And almost everybody that I've talked to said, I kept looking in that cloud for an orbiter to fly out, because we were thinking that we'd find a way to bring them back if an orbiter would fly out of the cloud. And of course, it didn't happen that day.
I watched the ascent
I saw the fireball. I screamed, please return to the launch site. I ran to the TV set, I turned the TV set on, and waited with the rest of the country as they played that fireball over and over again.
I knew those people, and I recall the last time at which I saw every one of them. When did I look in their eyes? What were the last words that were communicated between myself and each one of them? That kind of played through my head the last time that I saw them, what the occasion was and what we spoke of, and I remember the expression on their faces.
The films told us that the crew module came out more or less intact. We didn't get enough detail to determine what kind of intactness there was. For example, if the crew was still conscious or not conscious, able to make radio calls or not, that part we never really did determine. But we did not expect to see the crew module come out as one piece and be able to track it for some distance.
I knew we were dealing with a very vulnerable vehicle, a butterfly, which is riding on a rocket. I knew about those things. I knew it was vulnerable. I knew it was fragile. And I knew the risk was very high on this thing. But I did not expect when the accident occurred that it would be due to negligence.
It could have been prevented. It didn't have to happen. It wasn't one of those days where all the forces of nature ganged up against us. That the system, the people in the system, understood that we had a problem in the design of the O-rings, that a potential could occur for lost the vehicle due to burn through of the casing. But somehow we were unable to work the system properly to get those answers up so that we could take effective action. And so it was a human failing.
And I'll never forget that moment. Every time I go through the Denver airport, I know. And when you get to countdown, it never gets to be routine. It never gets to be old hat. You can't help as a human being not to have that nagging feeling that, have you ever done enough? You know, have you ever really done enough?
At this point, our forecasters are predicting only a 20% chance of violating our launch constraints at that particular time. And only a 20% chance of violating.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you, Mr. Talon. Have a good day.
Thank you. Y'all have a good evening.
Okay.
Get it up.
All right.
We expect to have some scattered clouds.
Everything else is on schedule. We're going to launch at 8:07 hours. The window extends to 13:09. Let's hope this goes on time.
We've loaded the tank and we're replenishing it, keeping up with what we call the heat leak, because it's not a perfect thermos bottle. So we have to keep adding a couple hundred gallons a minute of hydrogen and oxygen to the tank.
This is shuttle launch control at T-minus 3 hours and holding. Crew preparing to have the mission cake with the STS-59 mission emblem on it.
Godwin.
a strange thing. You do all this sophisticated training, you have all these people who do all this high-tech preparation, but it really does come down to a few people who take you in a bus out to the launch pad. They do strap you into this vehicle. And then you know that anybody in their right mind gets way the hell back away from this thing, at least 3 miles, and leaves you alone out there with all of this high explosives and makes you think very hard about doing this job.
Now on the way to launch pad 39A.
There is a ceremony, and I think it's a ceremony that we need as human beings. We need ceremony, and I think in this case, these are emissaries that we're sending out into space.
Excitement in the bus kind of builds too as we're coming down. I can remember going out and people saying, okay, one more corner. Oh, you know, look at that. Isn't it marvelous? Normally, you're used to arriving at the pad and finding all these workers, you know, scurrying all over the place, readying the vehicle for flight or readying the pad. Suddenly, you get out there and there's just the six of you on the crew and the six members of the team that are going to help strap you in and do the final hatch closing. And that's it. Those are the only human beings out there. And this big, beautiful rocket ship.
We're at the 195-foot level of the tower. Crew module's right here. There's an external tank that's not more than 20 feet to this side, and there's a solid rocket booster that's loaded and ready to go that's right next to it. So we're right in the middle of it. All of that's full, and we've got about 1 million gallons of liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen right there ready to go. So you're one of a dozen people that you're out here, and everybody else is 4 miles away.
Space, no longer an impossible frontier. The Discovery Channel presents the Space Shuttle. This two-hour Discovery special video presentation takes you behind the scenes for the first time as you witness the drama and majesty of the Space Shuttle firsthand from the people who've made it possible. To order the Space Shuttle for only $24.95, call 1-800-417-1616. The Space Shuttle, man's grasp has now equaled his reach.
There's only one place for the widest selection in front-wheel drive minivans. From high performance to high performance. From the long of it to the short of it. From emerald green to light driftwood. From the value priced to the lap of luxury. From seats that glide to seats that unfold. From grocery bags to airbags. From bumper to bumper, door to sliding door. The one place for it all is our place. The Minivan Store. At your local Chrysler Plymouth dealer today.
Dad, could you leave the door open a crack?
How's that?
Could you check the closet one more time?
Nothing here.
Are you sure there's nothing under my bed?
Nope, no monsters here. Okay?
Okay.
Good night, buddy.
Dad?
Yeah?
Could you leave the hall light on?
MCI has important news that will have the whole world talking. Now, Friends Around the World gives you the lowest-priced international calls to any three numbers you choose. And not just for a limited time. You'll get great savings every day of the week, every week of the year, to more than 280 countries and places worldwide. It's never been easier to call the people you choose. Call MCI today and join Friends Around the World. It's the best way in the world to save.
Whole Cornish hen.
Look, you're on track. Unlike those clowns yesterday who brought in some guy in a chicken suit.
Lose the chicken.
Introducing the Memo Express pager from Motorola for the messages you can't afford to miss.
Right now, the only place you'll want to buy tires is Sears. Sears' best-selling Goodyear tire, the Weather Handler, is on sale as low as $19.66, our lowest price of the year. All Goodyear Weather Handlers on sale now, only at Sears.
Discover the latest gadgets for home, work, and play. Check out the wildest inventions, the coolest toys. Join award-winning host Richard Hart as he does whatever it takes.
Excuse me.
To bring you the latest in high technology. on Next Step. Tuesdays at 10:30 Mountain, 9:30 Pacific on the Discovery Channel.
It set the standard in do-it-yourself books. But now, we've made the best even better. Introducing the all-new Home Repair and Improvement Series from Time Life Books. With new color illustrations, step-by-step instructions, and a new spiral binding so books lay flat. It's never been easier to save money and create the home you've always wanted. You'll learn how to build a deck your family will enjoy for years. The tricks of the trade to install a patio. Call now to examine decks, porches, and patios free for 15 days. Keep it for the introductory price of just $9.99. Use your credit card and get this Stanley tape measure absolutely free. Other volumes will follow. Keep only those you want. Cancel anytime. The new Home Repair and Improvement Series from Time Life Books. We've made the best even better.
Call 1-800-544-6665 now to get decks, porches, and patios for just $9.99. Use your credit card to order and get a free Stanley tape measure.
This is Shuttle Launch Control at T-minus 2 hours, 6 minutes. Mission Specialist Tom Jones is now being prepared for boarding Endeavour.
There you go.
You're kind of numb to the whole thing, I think. You're just excited a bit, and looking forward to getting in and strapped in and settled down. It's a bit uncomfortable like this.
Kind of laying on some bowels in the back of the suit, but it's not too bad for the first hour and a half or two. As you approach the, a little after that, you start getting a little uncomfortable with sometimes back pain. So the quickest way to get comfortable is to launch, you know. If you scrub, it takes about 40 minutes to get back out here and open the hatch and take you back. But if you launch, it's only 8.5 minutes to 0G, so that's the most comfortable end of the deal.
You get into that anymore, I'll put your booties on.
Good morning.
Morning.
How long have you all been cooking this morning?
The beans have become such a trademark to what we do here. It's like fish and loaves. There couldn't have been enough to go around, and it grew and it grew. And now it's a tradition, and we feel like the beans are part of our luck, and the beans are also part of the celebration.
Control, astronaut Duke Kidman, on the shuttle training aircraft. He can evaluate the actual weather conditions around the runway. Definitely waiting for his report before we commit to launch this morning.
I think that people become addicted. They go back time and again to watch them, you know. The people who live down there get up at all hours of the day or night when there's a bird about to go. You know, all the cars stop and watch it go.
The observance, it's almost like people going to watch the king bathe.
It is kind of a religion. I mean, it's like people are watching human beings leave the Earth, and it's a process that they want to be a part of.
Cloud pattern.
It's kind of like our Super Bowl day, and we're all hoping and praying and a little bit nervous. You have a little bit more butterflies. You're looking people in the eye that's worked with you. Everybody's scanning what they did over the last 90 days.
Yeah. Launch Director Bob Seek has just had another conversation with the launch weather officer. No, there is still a possibility that we will have a launch today.
It's not a 747 with wings out there, tied to those rocket motors. And when everything's right, we'll launch.
It's disappointing when you don't get one off the ground. You really want to get one off the ground. And we're real happy when it's just the weather, because that's out of our control. We know we did our job right.
Okay, let's go buy some ladders.
If in the first couple of minutes something goes wrong, where you can jettison the fuel tanks, jettison the solid rockets, and try to fly back for an emergency landing at the Cape. And you certainly don't want cloud cover over the landing strip under those conditions.
Our forecast is still no-go due to crosswinds. OBS have seen peaks up to 20 knots on the crosswind.
I support their decision, and we've exceeded the crew on back time by a few minutes already, and let's refactor for them all.
And that's all happening at the LCC over here, the Launch Control Center.
Power to give you a go.
Nice try, everybody, and our recycle for tomorrow will be to hit a 705. Local time, beginning of the window, 1105 GMT.
That's it, guys.
That's the business.
That's the business we're in.
When it scrubs,
my friend.
I know it sounds selfish, but there's a lot of work to do for a scrub turnaround for 24 hours.
What we'll do right now is we'll head back into the suit-up room and we'll de-suit them, and then the work begins. We've got about 6 more hours of work, and then it's off to get some sleep and turn and burn for tomorrow morning.
See you next time.
Copy. KSC area is clear for launch.
Copy.
And word that the blast danger area has been cleared of all personnel for the launch this morning. Still targeting 7:05 for our liftoff time.
Yeah, it's clearing up nicely.
Now checking the flight controls of Endeavour. Final check before liftoff of the rudder and ailerons, and we'll be checking the main engines.
You want to do it again?
Yeah.
Are you happy?
Go
back. Okay, and remember, walk out this way.
Go that way, huh?
Okay. Hej alle KTV-seere. Dagens videopostkort fra USA er faktisk lidt specielt i dag, for jeg står her ved Cape Kennedy.
T-minus 5 minutes.
Yellow says go for open APU start. TLT, OTC, perform APU start.
Work in space.
Good work.
Kevin Chilton now flipping 3 switches in the cockpit to start each of the 3 APUs. T-minus 1 minute. Now turning off the joint heaters on the solid rocket boosters.
Done with this, just laying it out.
TLS is go for auto sequence start.
Endeavour's computer is now controlling. 7, 6, main engine start, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff of the Space Shuttle Endeavour, observing the changes of planet Earth.
Speed now 1,000 miles an hour, 5 miles downrange.
Never go with throttle up.
Roger, go with throttle up.
Altitude 9 miles. 3 engines now back in full throttle.
Look at that shadow.
Altitude now 15 miles. Speed 2,100 miles an hour, 15 miles east of the launch pad. Flight controller standing by for burnout and jettison of the twin solid rockets. Yeah! Good solid rocket booster separation confirmed. Endeavour now 33 miles northeast of the launch pad, altitude 30 miles, speed 2,700 miles an hour.
Endeavour, performance nominal.
Copy, performance nominal.
That means now if it loses one engine, it can still make it to Africa.
Speed now 13,600 miles an hour, 600 miles northeast of the Kennedy Space Center.
5,000 miles an hour to go.
Paul's asking the last.
for speed 16,400 miles an hour.
Yeah, you gained on 3,000 there.
Present to Miko.
The longest 18 minutes in the world that exist from T-minus 9 until main engine shut off. And it's almost hard to breathe during that period of time.
Use officer confirms the good cutoff of the main engine.
All right.
Yes.
All
right.
Yes. Congratulations.
Slope. Good
job on
the engine,
buddy.
Nice job.
Good job, Mel.
Yeah.
Hey, nice job.
Good job, buddy.
We're up there. We everything's uphill, we call it.
You work for months, 2 or 3 months on an orbiter to get it ready. And when the engines light up and it fires off the pad, it's just like you feel it right in your gut. It's absolutely perfect. It's beautiful.
Couldn't be better. I mean, everything worked. No fits, funnies, fails, or falls. Hey, JB.
Well, it's a tradition at least, and when you got something working for you, don't change it. He's honed in on your beans here. Yeah.
Manned access to space, we feel, is on our shoulders. It has to be damn near perfect every time because we can't tolerate a failure. We can't tolerate it. It's a zero tolerance program.
I think everybody in NASA realizes that, and no one wants to make the small incremental mistake that puts the space shuttle at risk, not only again for the human tragedy, but also for the enormous political consequences. So this is an agency that lives in fear of making a little mistake and that grinds the wheels to a halt.
I think it is time for the American public to fish or cut bait. Either it wants to go to space or it doesn't. And if it does decide to go to space and it wants to keep the people in space, then I think it's got to grow up and it's got to decide that you take your hits. You pay for this with blood and treasure.
Should we crawl into a cave and assume the prenatal position and say, oh God, I'm so worried about launching a shuttle? NASA cannot live in fear. I tell our people to take risks, do everything possible to make it as safe as possible, but we will not stop flying. We've got to go to the boundary. Now, if America decides if we have a problem to cancel a program because we've lost that ability to take risk, I cry for America, not for NASA.
Coming up next, investigate the pros and cons of animal research and testing on the nature of things. Tomorrow at midnight Eastern and Pacific, communicate with the Earth's largest mammals on Discovery Showcase. Explore your world on the Discovery Channel. Discovery Channel and the Chrysler Corporation are proud to bring you the best in quality documentaries.
Between labels, and she ended up signing with Geffen Records. Lisa's band, Nine Stories, was named after the J.D. Salinger book. Excellent read, I might add. But she has a story of her own off the Reality Bites soundtrack at number 36. Here's Stay.
say. I talk so all the time, so
Cuban-born
entertainment, but we have a great.
Gentlemen call.
moths in your rugs. Do it. What's the use of mothballs in shallow shoals? English souls, do it. Goldfish in the privacy of bowls. Do it. Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
Once upon a time, long ago, long before the birds and the bees, animals reproduced by division. When its time had come, a creature simply split in two. Each half was identical with the whole. It was a simple thing, and it worked. But in its eternal sameness, perhaps a bit boring. But one day, something happened. Something new and profound. Instead of dividing by themselves, two creatures came together for a time to exchange the vital cells of their heredity. From this union, a new life would come, a different life. It was the beginning of sex, the fuel of evolution. It would bring an abundance of living forms, and the world thereafter would never be the same. Looks at nature with a lover's eye. He sees only what he wants to see. He seeks beauty, grace, and wonder. But mixed with these is the unyielding fact of mortality. It is a drama that enthralls us, all except the very end. Eating and being eaten, equally natural and equally inevitable, for the food of life is life itself. The tiny carcass of a mouse will become an incubator for the eggs of a common fly, and in turn the eggs will become maggots. Nothing is wasted in nature. Its efficiency defies the human imagination. Life itself never really ends. For every death, there is transformation. Days it is done, and after a period of inner development, the flies will emerge. One life is gone, hundreds more begin. Only bone remains of the mouse, but it will decompose in time. Bring rich minerals to the soil, and another form of life will surge ahead. Symbol of beauty, token of human affection, the flower is a sexual organ of plants. And the lavish seduction of the flower is but a lure for the chosen messenger of procreation, the insect. The flower's beauty veils its cunning. It yields nectar while coating the insect with its powdery sperm, minute grains of pollen. Innocent of its purpose, the insect is led to serve the sexual imperative of its host. In billions of happy accidents each year, the tiny but vital pollen grains find their intended target and prove the utility of the flower. We attend what pleases us, a field of color, a perfumed breath of wind. Yet they are merely incidental clues that the great impersonal machine of reproduction is raging on. The most powerful reproductive capacity in nature, and the most alien in human eyes has been bestowed upon the insect. His instinctive couplings are strange and indiscriminate. He may live only long enough to reproduce. Were the insect a philosopher, he might well proclaim, "I mate, therefore I am." A female green spider tolerates the cautious approach of a male. As with many insects, female spiders are as likely to attack a lover as accept him. But once his sexual organ, a specialized foreleg, is pulsing in her abdomen, his intentions are known, and he is safe. In the voracious insect predator, the praying mantis, hazards for the courting male are even greater. He approaches the female with extreme caution, seeking to mount her even before she is aware of his presence. The mating begins, and now the male is committed totally to procreation. Whatever happens, he will not attempt to escape. Continues to mate. Even when his head is severed, reflex will take over, programmed for the survival of the species. It's not known exactly why the female devours some lovers and allows others to leave unharmed. Possibly he has inadvertently triggered her aggression through some small but fatal breach of mantis etiquette. Certainly the female needs nourishment to brood her eggs, and he is a most convenient source. Whatever the answer, the mantis bears out a principle common in nature. The male role in reproduction is often brief, and there is no fundamental reason why mating should not be his final act. The female mantis will lay hundreds of fertilized eggs. Like most insects, she is a specialist in mass reproduction. An orb weaver spider squeezes from her body an egg mass almost as large as herself. This is the last climactic act of her life. The mother spider will soon die, but not before she has woven a protective cocoon around the eggs. Insulated against cold, they will survive the winter that she cannot. A voracious insect army constantly seems to threaten a revolution in the world, overwhelming and consuming all other life. More than half of every insect generation is mere fodder for other creatures. For each species, a host of ravenous enemies lies in wait. The richer the harvest, the more the predators will thrive. Reenact the mysterious ritual of spawning. Guided by instincts and senses that are little understood, a pair of trout select a spawning place which offers the greatest chance of survival for their young. Churning gravel with her tail, the female prepares a shallow nest to catch her eggs. Series of subtle signals, the couple are about to release sperm and eggs. In silent communion, they simultaneously reach climax. In a crucial instant, millions of sperm and thousands of eggs swirl together. Only some of the eggs will be fertilized, still fewer will survive to hatch. Yet the way of the fish has won survival for over 300 million years, far longer than any large animal that breeds on land. This was probably the first love song heard on Earth. Prehistoric ancestors of frogs and toads shattered the primeval silence with their mating chorus. First large animals to emerge from the sea, amphibians' reproduction still is tied to water. But unlike the subtle way of fish, frogs enact a clumsy parody of rape. Once clasped on a female, the male will cling stubbornly for days on end, awaiting the moment when her eggs will ripen. Though the female appears indifferent, the male's presence stimulates her production of eggs. His mating grip is so powerful, it sometimes leaves her scarred for life. As with fish, sperm and eggs combine externally. The exhausted parents will soon abandon them. Remarkably, the sex of many amphibians is not determined at conception. The eggs can develop into either sex. The proportion will be dictated later by environmental conditions. As many strange creatures have evolved, so have equally strange patterns of reproduction. Among the most bizarre and perhaps most admirable is the private life of the snail. In breeding season, any meeting of snails is a lover's rendezvous. for there is only one sex. Each has a complete set of male and female organs, and in their encounter there is an unexpected, eerie ecstasy. Formed at the neck. The two may remain joined for more than an hour. Each has organs equivalent of penis and vagina, and when they have done, each has inseminated the other. Snails will give birth, and they are blessed with the ability to delay the eggs until the time most favorable for their young. Hatched from a thin, translucent egg, all young snails are formed like their parents, destined to be both father and mother of their kind. The evolution of sex, the reptile brought new and complex means of reproduction. The courtship of lizards could be mistaken for a fight. Seemingly, the male bristles with aggression. The male will try to seize the female's body with his jaws. Already, her willingness is partly evident. Normally, she would have fled before now. This is courtship in its simplest form, a ritual which impels the pair to gradually lower their normal defenses. Mating, a brief time out from the battle for survival. Only in this moment will the lizard allow such intimate contact. The moment passed, each goes its separate way. The sperm and egg have combined inside the female's body. This is the reptile's most potent invention, protection of the young in the vulnerable early stages of life. In a burrow underground, the eggs emerge. Because she has kept them secure inside her, the female need lay only a few, compared with fish and amphibians. But she has no impulse towards maternal care. She'll soon leave the eggs to hatch, unattended. Guided only by instinct, the young fight their way free. From the first breath, they are active and alert. Within hours, the young lizards will venture out. Miraculously implanted in their infant minds are all the skills they'll need to survive. Soon, they'll be hunting and eating insects. It was once fancied that every bird song was a testament to love. Sadly for romantics, scientists have shown that birds sing for a variety of reasons. Still, the magic remains, an essential rite of spring. Fascination with birds is the male's bold initiative in courtship, and few courting birds have a more demanding task than the frigate bird of the Galapagos Islands. As a female passes overhead, the frantic male advertises for her favor. The huge red pouch on his neck has no function except to catch the eye of a mate. Even after a female has accepted him, the male frigate bird must endure savage harassment. Other birds try to drive the pair away, like an outraged Puritan community confronted with an illicit union. Is not over. It is the male's job to gather material for the nest. With rivals on the same quest, each twig becomes the object of a spectacular contest of dominance. Frigate birds breeding is an ordeal in which only the strongest will succeed. Yet the pairs formed now will dissolve at season's end, and next time, the rigors of courting will begin all over again. What the frigate bird achieves through display, the African weaver must accomplish with architecture. In the breeding season, he and other males compete in the building of nests. He weaves long stems of grass to form a basket-shaped ball open at the bottom. With exquisite craftsmanship, the weaver reveals the intricate workings of his untutored brain. It is this miracle for which we have no better word than instinct. The female weaver shows interest only when the nest is complete. In a materialism not without human counterpart, the home a mate can offer is her foremost concern. The weaver's reward, a mating which lasts only a few seconds. The female will now take up residence, but the male will build more nests for other mates, a tireless builder throughout the breeding season. In courtship display, the world of birds is uniquely colorful and varied. But these rituals have a common purpose. Male and female must synchronize their reproductive systems for mating, and they suit their actions to their need. Great Western Cree performs a courtship ritual remarkable even in the winged world. It begins with the bobbing of heads and becomes what can only be described as a dance. Many birds, like grebes, form strong bonds and remain together after mating to nurture their young. But this behavior is rare in nature. More often, male animals show no awareness of their role. A father's care is mainly known only to birds and to man. Necessity, rather than sentiment, forges the bond among birds. Neither alone could meet the appetite of the chicks, but almost invariably, the bond will last only as long as the need of the young. Gigantic breeding rookeries serve the survival of birds like the pelican. They annually migrate to the few choice havens where predators are scarce and food is abundant for the ravenous young. The chick's appetite all but overwhelms the adult pelicans. Sometimes when food is scarce, only the strongest chicks win enough food to escape starvation. The flamingo breeds in vast colonies throughout Central Africa. The infant birds have only 11 weeks to grow large and strong enough to fly. Their parents produce a highly nourishing form of milk that aids swift development. After a few days, the chick's parents must leave to find more food. The chick wanders through a forest of legs, crying to be fed. But all other adults are indifferent, if not hostile. For a time, the chick is a lonely and hungry orphan. Incredibly, when the chick's parents return to the rookery, they apparently single out and feed their own young. Exactly how they distinguish one among thousands of chicks remains a mystery. It is the end of a long, dry summer in the American West. Clouds of dust reveal a battlefield as the breeding season of bison begins. For much of the year, bison cows and bulls drift apart, but now the huge males are drawn to the herd of cows and compelled to fight. At issue is dominance. A bull's right to keep possession of a cow for mating. Slowly, over a period of weeks, the endurance and strength of each bull will be tested against the others. Fights normally end as if by mutual agreement. The outcome is acknowledged with subtle gestures that can escape the human eye. Only the bison may know which has won a given contest. Secure in his hard-won dominant position, a successful bull moves to tend a cow, staying close by her. By smell, he tests her readiness for mating. She is fertile in only 2 or 3 days of the year. With extraordinary precision, both cow and bull sense when this time has come. After mating, cows and bulls separate once again. The cows, many pregnant, herd together as they struggle through the winter months. Now, in spring, with the weather mild and food abundant, the time of birth has come. With evident pain, the mother will normally bear a single calf weighing 25 to 40 pounds. Immediately after birth can be the most dangerous in the life of a bison. For now, the infant must rise and walk almost immediately. If it fails, its mother may abandon it. Instinct impels her to stay close to the restless herd. Struggle is yet another means of natural selection. A defective calf will not survive. The strongest will quickly rise, but sometimes the issue of life and death hangs in delicate, suspenseful balance. Australia, stronghold of the kangaroos and other peculiar mammals called marsupials. Though strange in manner and movement, what truly sets these animals apart is their means of reproduction. It's such an incredible process Those who first described it were denounced as outright liars. The mating is normal enough. Females are fertile in monthly periods and will accept almost any male in the loose-knit kangaroo band. Only 40 days after successful mating, when the single baby is little more than an embryo, it is thrust from its mother's body. In another mammal, this would be a fatal miscarriage. The fetus is less than 2 inches long. Blind, guided only by touch and smell, it embarks upon a torturous journey, its very life at stake. It gropes upward across its mother's belly, seeking refuge in her pouch. The mother cannot help. If it falls or falters, it will die. Once inside the pouch, the baby must locate and attach itself to a suckling nipple. Here, it will remain and grow in safety. After this premature and dangerous adventure, several months will pass before the baby will leave the pouch. Development begun in the uterus is finished here. Until it is at least a year old, the baby kangaroo will enjoy the convenience of the pouch. It is at once his home, his transportation, and his source of food. Indeed, except for the hazardous manner of their birth, marsupials enjoy one of the best equipped mothers in the animal world. As with every animal, the kangaroo exists only because its ways work to its advantage. There are no rules of reproduction in nature, and nothing that promotes life can be termed abnormal. In all its intricate mechanisms, reproduction is the servant of a species' survival. Mice breed prolifically, simply because in nature they are so vulnerable. The age of maturity, strength of sex drive, and size of the litter all are geared to a high reproductive rate. Under optimum conditions, two mice will yield 200 in less than 6 months. Only man and the animals he keeps in captivity can transcend the normal checks and balances of nature. Both may avoid the threat of predators and enjoy an abundant supply of food. But sooner or later, unbounded fertility brings a crisis. In nature, birth control has always existed. In myriad ways, the urge to mate is related to the necessity of survival. Giant tortoises have no natural enemies and may live up to 100 years. They mate annually, but it is estimated that they need only two offspring every 10 years to hold their own. Higher primates like baboons mate frequently, but only one offspring normally results, and thus the reproductive rate is low. Some predators, like lions, can afford a prolonged and luxurious love life. A lioness comes into heat every 3 weeks. Over a period of several days, she will keep close company with a male. On the average, they will mate once every 20 minutes, around the clock. In prey animals, like the Uganda cob, mating is usually hurried, but the rate of conception is high, even though the act may literally be performed on the run. Elephants have rarely been observed mating in the wild. Cows are pregnant for nearly 2 years and then bear only one calf. But the elephants fear no predator, and their rate of birth is more than enough to ensure that they will survive. The various species of rhinoceros show a similar pattern. Male and female rendezvous as infrequently as once every 2 years, but the mating itself can continue for more than half an hour. The forces of life, molded to meet the demands of myriad environments, have dictated many strange reproductive patterns. Some defy all conventional notions. Daphnia, a tiny relative of the lobster, has reduced the role and significance of the male to an absolute minimum. Mating between the females and the much smaller males may occur only once in dozens of generations. For the most part, Daphnia females breed new offspring with no need of mating. The cycle of virgin births can continue generation after generation. In some rare species, the only sex is female, and mating does not occur at all. chill winds of fall warn a severe cold to come. Only a tiny fraction of the millions of Daphnia swarming below can survive the winter. Now females respond to the changing climate. They grow massive insulated egg sacs on their backs. Shed from their bodies, the sacs will lie dormant for months. But with the return of spring, they will hatch, and the species will be born again. Harsh demands of desert life have produced some of the most remarkable reproductive patterns. One begins with the mating of the Pepsis wasp. The fertilized female activates an elaborate strategy for survival. The only way her species can reproduce is through an incredible series of events. It begins as she seeks to find a dangerous enemy and do battle. By instinct, the wasp will only lay her egg on the body of a full-grown tarantula. Her quest is apparently suicidal. The tarantula is poisonous and both larger and stronger. The wasp will drag the tarantula back to his burrow. His own safe haven will soon become his grave. Design, the wasp has not killed the tarantula. It is merely paralyzed by her venom. If it died, it would be useless to her, for her egg will become a parasite on the tarantula's helpless body, stealing life to feed its own. The mother wasp is gone, sealing the burrow behind her. Over a period of weeks, the egg will become a larva and consume its victim. Last edible portions of the tarantula are gone. The wasp larva has swollen with new energy. Now it will seal itself into the security of a silken cocoon. Finally, after many months, metamorphosis is complete. Within the cocoon, the larva has become a wasp. If it is a female, as soon as she matures, she in turn will do battle with a tarantula. From tranquil summer seas in May and June, great numbers of Stella sea lions congregate on lonely Pacific islands. Mammals that have adapted to marine life, they still must return to land to breed and bear their young. Of bulls, twice as large as the cows, gather their harems around them. A powerful bull can dominate as many as 20 cows. Through the breeding season, the rookery rings with raucous cries of courtship and challenge. The larger the harem, the more difficult the task of the bull. He must drive away rivals and mate with all the cows in his harem. A cow bred the previous year is in the final stages of labor. For nearly a year, she has roamed Arctic oceans, but now returns to bear her pup on the same beach where it was conceived. Like most highly evolved mammals, sea lions produce relatively few young. Their key to survival lies in the quality of maternal care. In the first days after birth, the mother and pup will form a close bond. With more than 1,000 almost identical pups in the rookery, the mother can recognize her own by the sound of its individual cry. Aggressive rivalries often flare between cows in the rookery, but the bull usually intercedes when fights disturb the comfort of his harem. As the season wears on, the bull's peacekeeping instincts wane. More and more often, the cows are free to engage in vicious squabbles. Sometimes, the pups become innocent trophies of battle. A rival has stolen a pup, a frantic mother in close pursuit. The rival cow has hurled the pup into a deep rock crevice below. She gives every evidence of malevolent glee, while the mother desperately seeks to find her child. Such savage treatment of young seems without reason. But possibly, as a population grows too large, overcrowding causes more and more fatalities among the pups. A cruel but necessary form of population control, but no solace for a grieving sea lion mother. In a few remote African game reserves, the last remaining wild chimpanzees survive, man's closest living relatives. Only recently has their complex society been scientifically studied. The chimps are found to have highly individual characters. They form close and continuing relationships. Some are timid, others gregarious. In many ways, their behavior is much like humans, their personalities beginning to emerge early in life. In the wild, a chimp may live 40 to 50 years, but until it is 10 at least, it is not socially mature. The closest bond and the most essential for survival is between mother and child. The most carefree chimps seem to be the youngest, who are regarded with tolerant affection by one and all. Occasionally, older males break into brawling, aggressive displays. Dominance among them is in constant challenge. These encounters are more bluffing contests than trials of strength. But chimps lower in rank stay discreetly out of the way. In the normal sequel to disruption, chimps solicit gestures of reassurance and comfort. The need for physical contact in moments of stress is great, evidence of deep, underlying, dependent bonds. Touching the genitals and accepting a kiss is simply an elder's way of comforting an alarmed youngster. In chimps, sexual gestures often have a more general social meaning. Among the forces bonding the chimps together, the sexual attraction of a mature female coming into heat. The monthly estrus period is announced by a marked swelling of the female's sexual organs. Although she may refuse some, she will generally accept most interested males. (Clears throat) most matings are brief, lasting less than 10 seconds. Mating frequently draws excited spectators, especially the curious young. Surprisingly, couples react with only casual annoyance when interrupted. Sometimes a dominant male forces a female to leave the other chimps during her estrus. In this way, the general pattern of promiscuity is broken, with the stronger chimps having more opportunities to father young. It is suspected, but not proven, that chimps avoid some forms of incest. Matings between mother and son have never been observed, and between brother and sister, it is rare. A newborn, only hours old, the placenta still attached by the umbilical cord. This aging mother will be highly possessive for several months, always keeping the baby near. The mother's older children will suffer all the jealous pangs common among humans. Indeed, most of man's emotions are mirrored in the chimps. Yet they remain oblivious to certain intellectual insights, including the fateful awareness that mating results in birth. Man's original sin that he ate the forbidden fruit of knowledge, and none has suffered more from that knowledge than the beasts that serve him. Chicken is the most numerous in the world today, and it is a creature created by man to meet human needs. These chicks are hatched as nature would have them. Roughly half are male, half female, but so specialized is their breed that we have use only for the hens. The males are immediately identified and destroyed. Enlisted in the service of human need, the females are processed with coal deficiency. Injections guard them against disease. The hens' bills are clipped to prevent them from pecking each other. Removing a wing denies the remotest possibility of flight. The hens become a standardized component of flesh, condemned to serve their entire life within a gigantic machine. They are bred only to produce eggs, and that is all they will ever do. Eggs. Each one contains the spark of Genesis. And every day, more than 200 million are laid in the United States alone. It is a miracle of efficiency and organization. But it is also a measure of man's insatiable desire to bend nature to his own ends. Reproduction is still the slave of survival, but the survival served is no longer the chickens. Man first began selective breeding thousands of years ago, and he has never stopped improving his creations. The chicken itself may soon be obsolete. Super chicken, a giant variety weighing over 20 pounds, threatens to depose his puny relations. In a brave new world of animal genetics, gigantic stud bulls are the pampered stars. They bear the seeds of tomorrow's cattle, a superior master race to come.
$60,000 bull recently appraised at that figure. For his owners, not only has he been used in several outstanding breeding programs, but they have sold over $250,000 of semen.
Isn't he a magnificent thing? Give him a nice hand if you would, please.
Modern research centers throughout the world seek ever more efficient forms of cattle. This is a center for the production of superior sperm. The bulls here are prize specimens, but they will never see the thousands of calves they father and have never mated with a cow. Artificial vagina, one of many sophisticated aids for breeders. In the laboratory, it is sterilized and carefully warmed to the proper body temperature. Sexual instincts have never been allowed to develop normally, so it can be excited merely by exposure to another male. Increasingly routine and mechanized, techniques of semen collection and storage have eliminated any necessity for contact between male and female animals. Man is the intermediary, imitating nature just enough to accomplish his ends. Teased to a state of excitement, the bull is kept short of ejaculation. Electric motors allow the artificial cow to retreat as he attempts to mount it, simulating the behavior of a flirtatious mate. Bizarre it may seem, but artificial and controlled breeding is rapidly becoming the norm in modern agriculture. With a weekly ejaculation from a single super bull, 20 to 50,000 cows can be inseminated, creating a whole new strain of animals in but 1 year. And refinements are imminent. It is already possible to separate sperm that produces male and female, determining sex before conception. Soon, in both animals and man, the sex of offspring can be deliberately chosen. Precisely, breeders are able to design animals simply by selecting material from genetic banks. Techniques for freezing sperm are now so far advanced that it can remain potent in cold storage for several decades at least, possibly forever. Already, the majority of domestic cows in the developed nations are inseminated artificially. Over 7 million cows are served by fewer than 2,000 bulls in a single year. The procedure is swift and simple. Chances of successful conception are as good or better than a natural mating. Medical techniques now are perfected, which enable a prize cow to produce far more than the normal number of calves. Earlier, this cow was given drugs which caused her to superovulate, producing many eggs instead of one. Fertilized with superior sperm by artificial insemination, the eggs will now be surgically removed from her body. Dozen eggs or more will be obtained, and these can be implanted in the bodies of other cows, which will serve as substitute mothers. Eventually, a small select group of super cows will probably produce eggs in massive quantity, just as bulls produce sperm. Other cows of inferior breeding will take on the chores of bearing and nursing the young. The actual mother will recover swiftly from the operation. She will be ready to donate eggs again in a matter of months. As biological science progresses, the very concept of motherhood is being altered. With laboratory animals, researchers close in on an ultimate goal: growing animals in vitro, within a womb of glass instead of flesh. The egg and sperm of a mouse are combined, not in mating, but under a microscope. With special cultivation, the egg will develop normally for several days. Like an atomic reaction, an awesome dormant energy has been released. Still of microscopic size, the developing egg is transferred to an artificial womb. Chemical and electronic devices will supply all that it needs for further growth. In the next 11 days, under careful control and observation, the mouse will grow to term. Is a scene from the not-too-distant future. When it is born, this tiny creature will bear a fateful message for the world. For when the genesis of life can be so controlled, how long can it be before the child within the machine is man? Once upon a time, long, long ago, animals reproduced by mating. Although it worked, it was crude, troublesome, and inefficient. But one day, at the hand of man, something happened, something new and profound. He assumed control of fate, the reins of evolution, and the world thereafter would never be the same.
Never said a word, start to sing, spring, spring. When the little blue bell in the bottom of the dell starts to ring, ding, ding. When the little blue clerk in the middle of his work starts a tune to the moon up above. It is nature, that's all, simply telling us to fall in love. And that's why birds do it, bees do it, even educated fleas do it. Let's do it, let's fall in love. Cold Cape Cod clams, against their wish, do it. Even lazy jellyfish do it. Let's do it, let's fall in love. Electric eels, I might add, do it, though it shocks them, I know. Why ask if shad do it? Waiter, bring me shad roe in shallow shoals. English souls do it, goldfish in the privacy of bowls. Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
But I'll never forgive myself if we don't go all the way tonight. And I would do anything for love, but I won't do that. No, I won't. Some days I pray for silence, and some days I pray for soul. Some days I just pray to the god of
sex and drums and rock and roll.
And maybe I'm lonely, that's all I'm qualified to be. That's just one and only, one and only promise I can keep. As long as the wheels are turning, as long as the
No, I won't do that.
as there he is in all his glory, Meatloaf with I Do Anything for Love, at number 15 off his 1993 release, Bat Outta Hell 2, Back Into Hell. It's his sixth album over a recording career that began 16 years earlier with a mega release back in 1977 of Bat Outta Hell that has sold 23 million copies and in many ways still going strong. Up next, a video from a woman who has had her own hell with the press. That hasn't stopped her yet. Here's Madonna, Louise Ciccone, at number 14. Song at number 14, that was Madonna with Vogue. Now that's off both the Dick Tracy soundtrack, I'm Breathless, and her greatest hit CD called The Immaculate Collection. You know, right when you think you know everything about Madonna, you do a little digging and uncover that she was a baton twirler and a cheerleader in high school, and the president of the Glee Club. I'm just kidding. We got the boss of Brotherly Love for you when we get back.
Was an archaeologist. She was, you know, she was fabulous.
Madeline was a nymphomaniac.
Yeah, okay, she had a little problem with fidelity, you know, and I didn't happen to see it.
He's so secretive about his movies. How much information did he give you to entice you to want to do this?
Enough.
So what did he tell you?
Basically, it was a musical. One scene with Woody and a song and a dance was enough for me.
You know, I'm gonna kill myself. That's what I should go to Paris and jump off the Eiffel Tower. I'll be dead.
I've always wanted to be in a Woody's movie. I mean, who doesn't want to be in a Woody Allen movie? It's kind of extraordinary.
And now you got to do it. Was it intimidating?
No.
Not at all.
Mm-mm. No, it was thrilling.
You know, in fact, if I get the Concorde, I could be dead 3 hours earlier, which would be perfect.
Wow, she's right. I want to be in a Woody Allen movie, too. Don't y'all? Everybody. Doesn't everybody?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, one other thing that makes this Woody Allen movie unusual is that it's a musical that's funny intentionally. How about that? Barbara Streisand's no stranger to musical comedy. Her new film, The Mirror Has Two Faces, has earned her a Golden Globe nomination for Best Actress. Now, this song off the soundtrack.